Hello and welcome back. Well, in the last class, we did the chemical properties of alcohols, and today we'll be doing the chemical properties of phenols. So when I'm saying chemical properties of phenol, see, phenols means you got a benzene ring attached to OH group. And a very common reaction of phenol is aromatic electrophilic substitution reactions. Well, before starting with these reactions, I would like to tell you one thing, that OH group is electron donating group. Since it is electron donating group, it is ring activating and ortho para directing. It is ring activating and ortho para directing group. Well, we'll see the aromatic electrophilic substitution reactions as we have already done. We'll be doing in this section halogenation, nitration, sulfonation, and Friedel-Crafts reactions. So, if we talk about first, we'll talk about that is halogenation. Halogenation is a bit different in phenol. If you react a phenol molecule with bromine, when I'm saying bromine, I need not to balance bromine because bromine is in an excess. In the presence of AlCl3, the reaction can occur in the presence of two different solvents like water or carbon disulfide. Well, in the presence of water, I will get compound that is tribromophenol, OH, Br, second Br, and third Br. No doubt that in this case, I will get three molecules of HBr also. And when I talk about carbon disulfide, in the presence of carbon disulfide, I will get only monobromophenol, that is OH. Either at ortho position I'll have bromine, or at para position I will have bromine. Well, in this I would like to add one thing, that as far as the first compound is concerned, this compound, since its molecular mass is high, it will settle down in the form of white PPT. So this reaction can also be used as a test to detect the presence of phenolic group. That is, phenols on reaction with bromine water will give white precipitates. Now the question comes to our mind, why in the presence of water it is giving tribromophenol, whereas in the presence of carbon disulfide it gives only monobromophenol? Let us have a look at the structure of phenol. The structure of phenol is like this. Here you have got a OH bond. Well, water is a polar solvent which has got a dipole moment. Here H is positive and oxygen is negative. So this negatively charged oxygen will induce a dipole in the OH bond, where H will become positive and oxygen will become negative. As soon as the oxygen will become negative, it will donate the lone pair of electrons to the benzene ring. Thus, benzene ring will get activated for the attack of an electrophile. So it will lead to the formation of tribromophenol. Carbon disulfide is not at all polar. Since it is not polar, so it cannot activate the benzene ring like water did. And that's why it will not lead to the formation of tribromophenol. It will lead to the formation of only monobromophenol. And that can be either orthobromophenol or parabromophenol. This is all about halogenation of phenol. Next, we'll move on to the nitration. Nitration of phenol. If we talk about nitration of phenol, in that case, we have to react phenol with nitric acid. Now, suppose I am reacting phenol with concentrated HNO3, it will lead to the formation of trinitrophenol. So I will get a compound like this, that is OH NO2 NO2 and NO2. You can call it trinitrophenol, that is 2, 4, 6 trinitrophenol, or you can also call it picric acid, as it is commonly known as picric acid. If you react the phenol molecule with dilute HNO3, with dilute HNO3 you will end up only with ortho or para nitrophenol. That is, you will get a compound either like this or you will get a compound like this. As I have already told you that the stability of para isomer is higher, so para isomer is always found in a larger extent, that is 80:20 the ratio you will have over here also. Water, see here in this case, if I talk about HNO3, HNO3 will break up into OH negative and NO2 positive. NO2 positive being an electrophile will attack on the benzene ring, leading to the donation of H positive ion from the benzene ring. This H positive ion will combine with OH negative, leading to the formation of water molecule. So this is how nitration occurs. Next we'll see the third one is sulfonation. Sulfonation. In this case, I'm reacting phenol with concentrated H2SO4. I can write it like this. This concentrated H2SO4 will break into two parts, that is OH negative and SO3H positive. So in this case, SO3H positive is an electrophile. At lower temperatures, you will get ortho isomer, whereas at higher temperatures, you will get para isomer. So at low temperature, you will get a compound like this. That is SO3H, and at higher temperatures you will get compound like this. Well, in this case I can write the name of this compound as 4-hydroxy benzene sulfonic acid. The name of the second compound is 4-hydroxybenzene sulfonic acid. So the name of the first compound is 2-hydroxybenzene sulfonic acid. In this case again, H2O will come out as byproduct. So this is how this reaction occurs. At low temperature, let me explain you why at low temperature we get majority of ortho isomer and at high temperature we get para isomer. Well, as far ortho isomer is concerned, the two groups, that is sulfonic and OH group, they are closer to each other. they will experience prominent repulsion. So energy of the molecule is high. That's why the molecule is stable only at lower temperature. As the temperature will increase, already the energy of the molecule is higher, its stability will decrease. And so orthoisomer will become less stable, para will become more stable. So that is para isomer is formed in a larger extent. Next we'll see Friedel-Crafts alkylation and acylation. So next reaction is Friedel-Crafts. In this, first we'll see alkylation. Friedel-Crafts alkylation. I'm reacting phenol. With the CH3Cl in the presence of AlCl3, I will get orthocresol or paracresol. Again in the same ratio, that is 80 is to 20, so this is para Crisol. So we can have orthocresol or paracresol. Likewise, if I talk about acylation, I'm talking about acylation. So an acyl group will attack. In this case, again I'm reacting phenol, a phenol molecule, with CH3COCl. I'm carrying out acetylation because I've got acetoyl chloride. In the presence of AlCl3, it will break up into CH3C positive and Cl negative. So CH3C positive, C positive is an electrophile. Hence I will get a compound like this. OH CO CH3. This is the orthoisomer. I can also have a paraisomer. And the paraisomer can be like this. I can write the name of this compound as 2-hydroxyacetophenone. If this compound is 2-hydroxyacetophenone, then in this one we can write, it is 4-hydroxyacetophenone. So we have 2-hydroxyacetophenone or 4-hydroxyacetophenone along with the release of HCl molecule, because the Cl negative will combine with the H positive, which will come out. Wherever this acyl group will attack, H positive will come out, Cl negative will combine with that and it will come out as HCl. So this is all about the chemical properties of phenol. We have done chemical properties of alcohols and chemical properties of phenol. With this, alcohol phenol is over. Now we'll move on to the second part of functional group 1, that is ethers. Well, as for ethers are concerned, you know very well, we write them as ROR. But here I would like to tell you one thing, that the molecule is not linear as we generally draw it. It is pen-shaped like water molecule. So if you have got an oxygen atom, one alkyl group, another alkyl group, two lone pair on this oxygen, exactly like water. But in water, instead of alkyl group, you have hydrogen, which experience lesser repulsion. So they are quite closer to each other. That's why in water molecule, the bond angle is 104. Whereas in ethers, this bond angle is around 111 degrees. Because of prominent repulsion between these alkyl group. And whenever we write their name, we generally write it as alkoxy, alkane. Alkoxy, alkane. The smaller one always form alkoxy group. Suppose I got a compound like CH3, CH2, OCH3. Here in this case, the methyl group is the smaller one and ethyl is the longer chain. So ethyl will form the parent chain and its name will come out as word root. So very correctly, I'll write it methoxy ethane. I'll have methoxy ethane. Anyways, we'll start with their method of preparation as we do in all the functional groups. Method of preparation. We have two different methods of preparation for ethers and we have already done them. That's why we'll not do them again, but I'll recap them. The first one is from alkyl halides. From alkyl halides. This we have already done by the name of Williamson's synthesis. And not only we did this, but we also did the limitations of Williamson synthesis there. Second is from alcohols. This also we did. We did reaction with concentrated H2SO4 at 413 Kelvin. So we did the mechanism of that reaction also. These are the two methods of preparation of ethers. If we have a look at the chemical properties of ether, suppose here I have got an ether molecule and I want to see the chemical properties. We have two different type of chemical properties. That is the reaction involving the ethereal oxygen, which is not there in your syllabus, and reactions involving the breaking of carbon oxygen bond. So this is what we are going to do. So in chemical properties, in chemical properties, we'll see reactions involving breaking of carbon oxygen bond. In that we'll see or we'll do reaction with halogen acids. Reaction with halogen acids. Now suppose I have a compound like CH3OCH3, that is methoxymethane, and I'm reacting it with HCl. The carbon oxygen bond can break from any side, from here or from here. From anywhere it will break, and I will get a compound that is CH3OH, and along with that CH3Cl. If there is excess of HCl, this CH3OH will again react with HCl and will form another molecule of CH3Cl with the liberation of H2O molecule. This was symmetric ether. However, if I got an unsymmetric ether like CH3CH2OCH3 and I am reacting this compound with HCl. Now a question comes to our mind, where from the bond will break? Either it will break from site A or it will break from site B. In this case, I would like to tell you one thing, that since oxygen is the second most electronegative element, it will have a tendency of withdrawing electrons. It can withdraw electron from both the alkyl groups. If it will withdraw electron from methyl group, I will have a cation at methyl position. I will have a cation at ethyl position also. But we know that alkyl group is electron donating, So this methyl will donate electron to this carbocation, and the positive charge on this carbocation will become weaker. That means the positive charge on the larger alkyl group, a carbocation which is formed by the larger alkyl group will be weaker, because more the number of carbon atom, more will be the electron donation. That means the carbocation of methyl is weaker. So Cl negative will very readily attack on the methyl carbocation, and it will lead to the formation of CH3Cl and CH3CH2OH. That means if I have got unsymmetric ether with the same type of alkyl chain, it means there is no branching in both the chains, then the smaller alkyl group will have a tendency of forming alkyl halide, whereas the larger one will form alcohol. Now we'll see another example for this. Suppose I've got a compound like CH3CH3CH3OCH3 plus HCl. We know that 3 degree carbocation is very highly stable. That means this carbocation is so highly stable that it can exist independently. Now, since it can exist independently, this carbon oxygen bond will break very readily. It will break and the 3 degree carbocation will detach itself from oxygen. So if we talk about Cl negative, the only choice the chloride ion has got is to attack on this 3 degree carbocation. So it will attack on this 3 degree carbocation and will lead to the formation of compound like CH3, 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 Cl, and another compound I will get is CH3OH, that is methanol. So if the stability of carbocation is so high that it can exist independently, no doubt that carbocation is going to form. It will detach itself from oxygen, the bond will break from there, and that will form the alkyl halide. Next we'll see for aromatic ethers. Now when I'm saying for aromatic ethers, suppose I have got a molecule of inosole. This is a molecule of inosole, that is methyl benzene I have got. If I reacted with HCl, now the question comes where from the bond will break. Here in this case I would like to tell you that the bond between oxygen and benzene will have a double bond character. You'll have a double bond character here. So it is very difficult to break this bond. The only option left is between methyl and oxygen. So in aromatic ethers, the bond between oxygen and benzene will not break. The bond between oxygen and other alkyl group will break. And as a result of that, in reaction of such an ether, always you are going to have a molecule of phenol along with a molecule of alkyl halide. You will not get aryl halide, because that the bond between oxygen and benzene will have a double bond character. It will not break easily. So this is what you people have to take in care while doing such reactions, that is reaction involving breaking of oxygen and carbon bond. If we talk about aromatic electrophilic substitution reactions, like OH group, the OR group is also electron donating. So if I draw a benzene here, again I will have OR, which is electron donating group, and ortho para directing. When I am saying it is electron donating or ortho para directing, that means it will undergo all the electrophilic reaction, all 5 electrophilic reactions, and the electrophile is going to attack at ortho and para position. So there's no any means, we will not have any special reaction in this. If you carry out the bromination, you will get ortho and para isomer. If you carry out this nitration, you will get ortho and para isomer. If you carry out sulfonation, then again you will get ortho and para isomer. So I'm not writing those reactions here, they are quite easy. And you carry out reaction with any of the electrophile, like I'll show you, like we did in case of phenol, like here we did in phenol, like Br2 in the presence of AlCl3. So as in the second reaction you have Br at ortho and para position, that will happen. You will not get tribromo isomer in this case, and instead of OH you will have OR. Likewise, when you carry out nitration, you will not get trinitroisomer in this case. You will get ortho and paranitroisomer as in the case of phenol. Likewise, if you carry out sulfonation, you will get ortho and para isomers like in the case of phenol. Instead of OH, again you will have OR. And in Friedel-Crafts alkylation and acylation, again the alkyl and the acyl group will be at ortho and para position like in the case of phenol. And again, instead of OH, you will have OR group. So this is how these reactions they occur. And since we do not have any special reaction in ethers, means aromatic electrophilic reaction in ethers, so I am not writing those reactions here. And this is all about functional group 1. Well, student, here I would like to add one thing, and I would like to tell you this thing, that I met some of the students and I have seen their concern that means they were not even aware of the videos I was uploading on YouTube. I will request you one thing. Please subscribe this channel so that whenever I upload any video, you will get a notification of that. And it is very important for you. Like I've come across a situation where I uploaded the videos of solution chapter, and some of the students, they were not aware of this. Today when I told them that I have already uploaded, it was already late because their exams, they are already starting. So if you are preparing and you want to get that news on time, that notification on time, my humble request is that you please subscribe this channel so that you'll get all the notifications. And this is all what we are going to do today. Thank you very much for joining.